Okay, before we move directly to the matters and questions, there was an issue raised, I believe, by the council with regard to key workers and the reference to key workers in the statement, and whether that had been actually referred to previously in the representation. Mr. Edwards, are you satisfied that that's the case now?
Yes, sir. Thank you for the clarification you provided in the executive seat on the basis that you were going to
be. Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Okay, in which case, can we move then to the. There's only one question. Is the plan saying that the allocation of this site for the government as proposed in development representations, and if so, why? So, Mr. Kingston, do you wish to get off of that?
Yes, I'm happy to do that. And if at any stage I'm telling you something which you've been told dozens and dozens of times before, I hope you'll say it's not my intention to weary you, but to, as far as possible, at least engage you in the process that on day 53 you must feel as though it's endless. From our point of view, here, the notes that you provided with your question are, if I may say so, helpful, and particularly note 3, where you invite the council to indicate effectively what the documentary process has been in order to consider the question raised. And we did not invite you to make the following documents. I'm going to provide you, I hope, with an accurate list of them. And then when I've done so, I'm going to turn to other members of the team who are here to invite them to tell you why those documents they think are relevant and what it is that we want you to consider particularly in them. So the documents are, first of all, our own representations, the 2013 representations, which will have the representatives' number on them. And the reason for drawing particular attention to those is to invite you to note that in accordance with all of the guidance from the inspectorate, that these representatives set out their case in full at the beginning. They front-end loaded the process. They should therefore have been made out at all about what this case was about and the basis upon which it was being said that the plan was unsound. The second document that we invite you to have regard to is the 2012 Greenberg study, that's RD Strat 210. You'll get some enlargement of the point in just a few moments, but the essence of the point in summary is that substantially the representation site was treated as one block, sector 8, high or very high in terms of its greenbelt importance. The third document was the January 2013 sustainability appraisal, that's RDCR 380. This is one of, I imagine you must be dizzy with the red, amber, green documents, the value of which sometimes escapes me, but red, amber, green. And you'll notice in relation to the site that it is in essence treated again as a whole block in terms of the Greenbelt landscape assessments, and that it scores substantially red in those terms. There were, in terms of economic effects in that same sustainability appraisal, a series of questions that they were, and the details set out in our statement, natural energy statements, I think, deal with the detail now, a series of irrelevant questions, frankly. Are you taking existing employment land or are you in a deprived area? Irrelevant questions for the purpose of considering the specific site. The fourth document was the March 2014 Development Strategy Update. That's RD sub SUB SC 060. The focus of the council's attention in that document, as far as this site is concerned, appears to have been what they simply refer to as the quantum of development. The repeated references to the quantum of development, not a consideration of what the representation was actually about, the specifics of it. For example, the alignment of the representations with CBC and the desired synergy with that important facility. The council's obsession seems to be simply with quantum, not with what the development proposed was about. And then the fifth and, for these purposes, final document was the SA addendum of November 2016. That's RD MC021. This is another red, amber, green. And again, looking essentially at the whole site, and not, again, differentiating, not having regard to what is being proposed in terms of the particular proposal, the same irrelevant economic issues, questions, and in terms of transportation, a confession at page 262, the assessor did not know where the site was. At page 431, the suggestion that there was to be an access off the Hawkston Road between the M11 junction and Attenborough. No such access has ever been suggested. A series of inaccuracies. Those are the documents in play, those are the particular points. Now, just before I turn then to, first of all, Mr. Carpenter to run through these matters, just in one matter of context.
Sorry, I should ask you to, yes, sorry, carry on, we'll do that when you finish.
So, I'm happy to do anything at any stage that facilitates the process and any understanding of what we're engaged in, which otherwise must look rather arcane, mustn't it? This is just some context. The context, the bigger context, is set out in our matter statement. But it would invite you to note that in relation to these representations, we have no issue with the way in which these plans set out their objectives and the policies that they say have been put in place to achieve those objectives. And in summary, we note that the plans recognise, firstly, the need to support economic growth in Cambridgeshire as a world leader in the life sciences field. That's the CCLP objective 10, the SCLP, the objective embraced in policy S2A. Secondly, the plans specifically support CBC and Brooks and development there. That's policy 40 of the CCLP. But thirdly, there is specific support for the life sciences sector. It's recognised as being highly specialised and to be supported as that highly specialised sector. That's policy 16 of the CCLP. Fourthly, the councils acknowledge the appropriateness of specific occupational restrictions through section 106 agreements in relation to uses at CBC and related development areas. They clearly regard the use of those restrictions as being justified, in other words, justified by the specifics of the use, the importance of it, and the location. And what would expect to see that being rolled out in an approach to a consideration of representations. And fifthly, the national importance of the life sciences sector and the importance of it, not just economically, but also in terms of its health effects, nationally and internationally, is clear. Rely on those elements of the plans to which I've already drawn attention, and also to the Med City letter of the 28th of April 2017 attached to the statement, our matter of only two statement. So those matters are not an issue. The issue as we see it here is that local plans are not sound, however fine and clearly expressed the objectives might be, if the policies and proposals in the plan do not make provision for the effective delivery of what the objectives seek. And our representations are focused on delivery in relation to those objectives. And we make it quite clear, and I hope the National Liberty Statement is clear, it is our submission to you that short of the allocation of this representor's site, the plans are not sound because they will not have engaged with delivery in relation to what are admittedly important objectives. I'm going to pause there, if I may, and I'll turn, first of all, if I may, to Mr. Carpenter, and perhaps if I could do the introductions. If we do the introductions now, my name is Martin Keats, and I'm Queen's Counsel. I'm instructed by Mr. Carpenter on behalf of the representatives to present their case today. Next to me is Mr. Mike Carpenter from Code Planners. He's a chartered town planner, among other things, professionally. Then is Ms. Emma Jiggs, who is an associate with SLR, who have dealt with the landscape and rebuild aspects of these representations. You have a report from them as an appendix to the matter of Liberty statement. And then we have Mr. Nicholas Anderson, who, among other things, is a chartered engineer and a fellow of the Chartered Institute of Highways and Transportation, the regional director of AECON, and he's dealing with the transportation aspects of the proposals. Satisfactory by way of introduction, for you. Then, if I may, I'll turn then to Mr.
Sorry, Yes.
Good morning, Sir. Good morning, Sir. I'm Sir. QC, Barrister for Council.
John Dixon, Principal Planner for Services, South Cambs. We have, sitting behind a few others that may join as necessary, Lou Mason Walsh, the Logging Manager from Cambridgeshire County Council for Transport. Jeremy Smith, Head of Transport Policy at the County Council. And Stephen Miles from the Cambridge City.
Good morning, Charles Crawford for LDA Design. I'm supporting the councils on green belt and landscape matters.
Good morning, David Robertson, South Cambs and Robertson team.
Okay, thank you. Before I bring in Mr. Carpenter, a couple of other housekeeping issues I should have raised at the start. Firstly, if we need to evacuate in an emergency, could you just explain how we go to work here?
Thank you. We're not expecting a fire drill, so if the alarm does go off, please proceed downstairs. There's a fire exit at the bottom and gather at the back of the car park and avoid further disruptions.
Thank you. There's some attendances at the back of the room. Could everyone please sign in before you leave? If you have a mobile phone, could you outside the switch on to silent mode or off for the duration of the hearing? We aim to complete by 1 o'clock, but hopefully we'll have a break mid-morning. Okay, Mr. Carter, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Just wanted to pick up and go through some of the details that Mr. Dixon has just explained on some of those other documents. But can I ask, just as a start, perhaps, if you have in front of you Appendix 4 of my statement, Matter 11.2 statements, particularly the plans that are associated with that, because I think that helps to orientate us to where we are and also the proposal. All of the plans, I think, will be referred to as we go through this. They start from a higher level of what the site is and move down to a full scale, a large scale, and then to the development. I think the two important things to note at the moment are the location of the site in relation to Addenbrookes. And CBC, and the road network, and also the very rather specific form of development that is proposed in the master plan. And the master plan we have in Appendix 4 is very similar, it's rather just a change of format, to the master plan that accompanied the 2013 original representation on the submission draft plan. Also on the first of that, those plans, you'll find an extract from the Parry's suggestion for how Cambridge might grow within a compact city concept. And that is drawn from a document which is the Cambridge Green Belt 2016, which is attached as an appendix to Matter 6, Matter 6 statement in the Green Belt. You'll note in terms of location on that extract that it's got some blue colours, the darkest blue colour, which indicates the proposed new sub-regional centre south is this site. So the point of pointing it out is that that is the only place I have actually found an attempt at referencing the definition of a compact city. The compact city does not seem to me to be an excuse to say it should be small. It is a compact city which is accessible, and I've quoted in Matter 11.2 some development quotes from the Cambridgeshire Green Belt 2016 document. So I think with those in front of us, I think then if I just take you through very briefly each of these assessment documents, and as Mr. Kingston said, you've hopefully asked the council to identify which documents they assessed, which documents they assessed the site of the event through the process. And it does start with the 2012 Green Belt assessment. So hopefully I'll give you the reference numbers again, which is RP Strat 210. Well, this is a document you'll recall that we had some concerns about in the letter of May 2015, where there seemed to be a good deal of inconsistencies between the parts of sites and sites in the definition of high, medium, importance to Greenbelt. The point of this is simply to point out that this deals with Sector 8 with very little fine grain assessment. In this particular one, they looked at sites 2 and 4 either side of the rugby club, but the whole of that Sector 8 was identified as very high importance to the Greenbelt. It was looked at as a site, also a single site. No reference to the proposed development that was coming forward. Perhaps not surprising at that stage, because that was 2012 before the submission plan. We then get to the sustainability assessment pro forma of January 2013. This is RVCR 380, and this is the red and the green. And if you go through that document, and a quick glance will tell you immediately that there are, on the first two pages, some substantial amounts of green, of red, They are all under the title of Green Belt. What follows are a substantial body of Canberra and Green, which are all under various other particular headings. The point being that Green Belt is where, in the sustainability appraisal in 2013, it was red. Everything else had something going for the site at least. But again, the questions raised in the sustainability appraisal were not specific, were not helped, assisted by a knowledge then of what the proposal was that was coming forward.
Can you give me a page reference for that document?
Yeah.
For your site?
Yes, it's page 357, and it deals with two sites, but not together, so the two sites were part of our site, which is within South Cambs district, and this part of the site is in Cambridge City, Cambridge area, lumps them all together and deals with them as one.
It's just I know these are very substantial documents, when I come later to it, if I put a page reference, it's hugely valuable.
Yeah, no, I completely understand that. Yeah. So it starts at page 257 and goes on to this is a document which, as I say, is pretty general, and I think this is what you'll notice as you go through all of these documents. They are very general. They are not cited. They don't look at the site in any detail. They don't look at the use proposed in any detail whatsoever. But if, just by way of indication of that, on page 367, under the assessment of supporting economic growth, the three questions are simply, how far is the nearest main employment centre? We scored Amber on that because we are 1 to 3 kilometres from an existing employment centre. It's a very general question. Our case has always been that it is actually very important that we are in close proximity to a very particular employment centre dealing with very particular matters. The next question is, would development result in a loss of employment land, identified in the employment attribute, or clearly not? It's not an employment site at the moment. It's supposed to be, but it's not at the moment. And then, would allocation result in development in deprived areas of Cambridge? Well, it's amber, and it simply says not within or adjacent to the 40% most deprived super output areas within Cambridge. Again, this is the point of our particular proposal to provide employment space for a very specific and particular form of use so important to Cambridge, UK and the world. So again, it illustrates the generality of the assessments that the Council are undertaking at this stage of the design process. And that was after the representations to be made. So we then get to the next assessment, that's the Schwa sites, that's May 2013, and this is one which deals with various matters in a very general sense again. Again, not dealing with, sorry, I've just been a page reference again, 404.
You've got the document reference
as well. Well, that's the one I haven't got, document reference.
We'll
come back to that.
We'll come back to that.
You have a page number and a document.
Well, I can probably find that one relatively easily.
We'll find it in the brain. Yeah. Okay. So again, that goes through in very general terms of looking at this site, 878, as much as in there. We then move to 2014, March 2014. So again, this is well after now the representation was submitted, the submission draft. This is RD SUV SC016. This is Cambridge and South Cambridgeshire development strategy update. And this is where they looked at the references we were making to plan B and plan C. And they say on page 921 on the Cambridge South, where we say the plan is not sound because it has not been positively prepared based upon the carefully assessed needs. The council would disagree, and they say that the earliest stages of plan making were founded upon a substantial body of relevant evidence concerning the quantum of development. And that word quantum pops up in several other quotes in their disagreement with our reference to plan being unsound. The point here being, again, is the quantum. It's always the quantum. It's always we've got enough employment land, we've got enough residential land within Cambridge City and South Cambs. Again, no attempt to look at the very specific use that we were proposing for a very specific purpose, specifically located in close proximity to CBC neighbourhoods, for the benefit of both employment and residential, as I think that would become one action and one two statement.
Sorry to interrupt, but could you provide the references to part of that document you just referred to again?
That's RDSUBSC060.
And the
date? March 2014. It's called the Development Strategy Update. We then move to 2016. So this is the SA addendum. Again, this is looking at the whole site. In one lump, in the same way that we talked earlier on about 105878, part of the site in St. Cambs and part of the site in Cambridge City, again, looked at in one whole lump. And again, this is a document that is got slightly different headings through the SA, red and green document, but boils down to pretty much the same. Under Greenbelt, landscape and transport, yes, we score poorly in red, and the other colours are amber and green, generally. There's a couple of reds in there. This is the one that Mr. Kingston referred to. This is us now getting really even more uncomfortable than we were before in believing that the council had looked at and properly assessed the site in detail, or indeed the proposed uses for the site. And the efforts that we have always made to mitigate the harm that might have been caused. And this is the reference on page, this starts on page 252 of that document. And the reference that I'm going to quote here is on page 262, which under transport cycle reuse, it says, the precise geographic extent of this site is not known. It is 3 years after we submitted the first representations. If it is possible to link through the site direct onto Adam Brooks Road at its junction with Glebe Farm Drive, this would mean the site has adequate cycle links for onwards travel towards the city centre and or Cambridge Biomedical Campus. Now, two things to add to that. Firstly, if it links onto Adam Brooks Road at the junction with Glebe Farm Drive, it would have adequate cycle links. Point one. It does have access onto Adam Brooks Road at that point, and it's always been shown to have that access. And secondly, even in 2016, the council's assessments, this is their sustainability assessment, part of their sustainability assessment, the precise geographic extent of this site is not known. So again, very uncomfortable about the council's statements that they have properly assessed this site in their documentation. Can I just go to the plan that we've got, just to make sure we've got a clear understanding of what it is for us in terms of that quote on Edinburgh's Edinburgh's Road. So you can see Edinburgh's possible future, the Edinburgh's site to the east, outside Cambridge South. And Edinburgh's Road is the road which runs back to the better looking on the master plan itself. Edinburgh's Road is shown there, and the access onto Edinburgh's Road is shown and has always been shown at that point. Okay. So I think probably if I finish there for a couple of moments and leave us with the thought that the assessments that the council have undertaken in your point three, when we look at them, they are assessments of a very general nature and not site specific or use specific.
Do you wish to come in there, Mr.
Yes, I'm going to ask Dixon to begin and then I may have one or two observations to make.
If I start with some referencing. So I think our statement takes through documents and referencing fairly effectively, so I'll try not to repeat too much. That clearly takes it through the issue and options process all the way through to where we are now, including the modifications consultation. That includes the referencing of various SA documents at the various stages, including page numbers in each case. So I don't think I need to go through those, it's got them in writing. There's various references to the council not being aware of what is proposed in this objection. I think clearly the amount of trade we have over this site, over the examination shows the council is well aware of what is proposed for this objection. It might not be we necessarily agree with the evidence of various aspects, which again we talked about before, or the outcome of various assessments, but I think it is clear from the evidence that the council is well aware that this includes an element of employment and the nature of employment that's referenced in the various documents, including the sustainability addendum and the site assessment, that clear reference to there being employment proposals on that site. There's been various references to the council only being aware of quantitative issues. But again, I think I would disagree with that statement. Again, we've significantly debated the employment issue, but the council's case has consistently been that we have been aware of qualitative issues across the Cambridge area and the needs of particular employment sectors and geographical needs of those. I think it's clear that at previous matters the council and the objector clearly disagreed, particularly relating the need for provision specifically on this site and for an adequate subsector, if I can summarise it in that way. On some of the more detailed points, there's a few points there made on transport matters. If we get into detail on transport here, I'll ask my colleagues to come to the table. On the cycling point, to complete those assessments, we very much worked closely with the cycling officer from Cambridge City Council. We've had questions and issues regarding the site they're captured there. I think it is a fair summary that the development was still in its various stages. We had some drawings to go from, and she was expressing her concerns. We're not saying it's not possible to connect the site by cycling. The concerns first were that there are significant barriers that need to be overcome with this location, particularly caused by the major roads that surround the site. I think that's what she was expressing in those comments. On the highways point, which is the access point, which draws about the access onto Hawkesbourne Road, yes, that comment doesn't appear to be correct based on the latest master plan in front of us. In the transport modelling, we didn't assume an access onto that road, so I don't think that changes the fundamental outcome consideration of transport on this site. Yes, we acknowledge that its plans not include an access onto the Robertson Road, but we can deal with the transport issues
help as the rain progresses.
Yes, thank you. So, could I just see your writing? They're largely points of reference. In the list of documents to which the promoters indicated they were likely to refer, first given by Mr. Kingston, a slight variation by Mr. Carpenter. Can I just ask you to add two references besides some of the documents referred to? First reference is Mr. Kingston, that is document number two, refers to the 2012 rebar study, that's RB Sprout 210. So can I ask you to note and to have regard to the 2015 inner rebar boundary study carried out by LDA of RBMC 030. And then Mr. Kingston's fourth document, which was RBSC SUB 60, which was the development strategy update, I think, 2014, referred to. And I invite you also then to have regard to the development strategy update of 2015, RBSC 060. Well, the second point, so the implicit express criticism about the level of detail provided to the proposed development in the SA process. Mr. Dixon's touched on this. Can I invite you to note and have regard again to RDMC 021, which is the sustainability phrase of addendum, at page 252, which sets out the heading proposed uses, the nature of development that the promoters were seeking that stage to bring forward, and sets out that it's employment-led mixed use development with 85,000 square metres of science park and 1,250 homes and other associated developments. So it is plain, that the nature of the proposed development being advanced by the promoters was very much considered in the context of the SA process, and in particular in the agenda document to which I have referred. And then, finally, please, so far as the wider issue is concerned about the extent to which there needs to be CBC phase 2, which is extended by the Life Sciences course based on the Southern Secretary of Cambridge associated with the CBC, that is a matter of which you have heard a very considerable amount of evidence and submissions during the course of the examination. I think this is the fifth occasion in which Mr. Carpenter has appeared in the examination, making very much that point. There is a fundamental disagreement between the Council and the promoters as to the extent to which provision in that regard needs to be made. I don't intend to go through that again today, I believe, but clearly, as far as that is a point that is being brought forward as a driver, or a significant benefit derived from the allocation of this site, is not a point that the Council accepts. I mean, it's entirely appropriate the Council not to rely upon that benefit, which it doesn't accept in assessing the merits of this permission site in the SA process. And finally, just putting a marker down on this issue, detail issue that was raised by Mr. Dixon and by Mr. Carpenter about a reference to access from the Hawkston Road. I think it was given in particular from a point that was raised on page 264 of the SA addendum RDMC 021. We'll just, during the course of this morning's hearing, just check actually what was before the Council in terms of information at that stage, and then come back to you if there's any factual arguments for clarification. But in any event, and as you will see, so in terms of access from the Council, the Council has to make any particular point on that. It certainly is a point on access from the M11, but even if things have moved on in terms of the northernmost access from the M11, there was one point
reference is confined to a capacity and the concept of compactness. A capacity is mentioned specifically within what I refer to as Cambridgeshire 3.1. And for reference, the origin and historic development of Cambridgeshire 3.1 was set out in the Council's Matter 6 statement, and specifically Appendix 6 to that statement. And just very briefly, it was the 2003 Structural Plan EIP report that defined the Cambridgeshire 3.1 purposes and what I think is their final and ongoing form after a period of evolution prior to that.
I'm very conscious as no doubt at all you both are about the amount of paper, but length has never equaled strength in many contexts, not least this one. The reason we draw attention to our original representations was to invite you to see how focused they were. We didn't simply say we want a big release of employment land to the south of Cambridge, 85,000 square metres, and we'd like some housing trees to go with it. We had a very focused proposal, and Mr. Carpenter, as far as I'm aware, faithfully adhered to the view throughout that this is not just employment land, it's employment land with a specific focus related to those objectives I referred to earlier. Those objectives being of acknowledged importance, both economically and from a health point of view, nationally and internationally. So we acknowledge there's a lot of paper, but what you're entitled to ask and to look for the answer to is, where is the response to the representor's case, which indicates that the council has read it and appreciated what it is, and then has responded to that case, not so as to say, well, the quantum of development is being considered in the source of employment and elsewhere. And I remind you, if I may, you said for reasons which are perfectly obvious, please don't be to us on other sessions, that if I may remind you of the content of Appendix 9 of our statement on matter SCA 7A.1 and 3. SCA 7A.1 and 3.
I don't recognise that. Is it SC 7?
Oh yes. this is issue SC7A.1.
Yes,
I'm getting the letters the wrong way around.
You slipped in an extra A. Yes. That's what confused us.
They're so acronym laden on here, but if I confuse it, it's SC7A.1 and 3, and Appendix 9. And we gave you in Appendix 9 an extract from the planning practice guidance, which, among other things, at the fourth paragraph of the extract, told you that the sustainability appraisal should identify any likely significant adverse effects and measures envisaged to prevent, reduce, and as fully possible offset. And then this: the sustainability appraisal must consider all reasonable alternatives and assess them in the same level of detail as the option the plan maker proposes to take forward into local plan, preferred approach. In this instance, there can be no doubt at all that the council was being offered an alternative. It was an alternative which they never suggested was not a reasonable one. It was detailed, and as Mr. Edwards, I think, confession earlier indicates, it identified, for example, key worker housing, a specialist and focused employment offer, and other specifically aligned with the plan's acknowledged objectives, with which, as I've said, we do not agree. You are in the circumstances, then, as I said earlier, entitled to expect that there should be a response which grapples not with generalities, but with the particular. Because the reasonable alternative here is particularized. This is a separate point, then, responding to what Mr. Dixon was saying about the cycling. You got the point about the cycling offer, and we clearly have got what the council regarded as being good links. But the point about the reference to the cycling offer was to flag up that in that document, the council was confessing to a relatively late stage that it was unclear about the geographical extent of the site. That, you may think, is a somewhat difficult position to be in circumstances where you're attempting to undertake an SA, the same level of detail was planned rehearsals, and to which you might have thought was an obvious answer by any convenient means of communication, I ask. But the council didn't. Then Mr. Edwards points, we don't overlook, and haven't in our representations overlooked, the 2015 IGP assessment undertaken by LDA C030 reference document. But it takes no different approach with regard to the differentiation of the different parts of the site and their repo functions. It doesn't advance the council's case at all in terms of the consideration of alternatives. The SA process, the sustainability appraisal addendum, that's a 021 numbered document, again, that doesn't advance the council's case at all because it simply doesn't grapple with the specifics, for example, of the proposed link to the importance of that link to CPC. In relation to matter 11.2 statement, that's the current statement, if you will see that we have evidence from JLL, Jones and Marcellus, that is, from creative places, from Bailey Vending Associates, BVFP, which descends to not an inappropriate degree of particularity, but an appropriate degree of particularity to allow you to ask whether or not, if we adopt the approach which the representatives suggest is necessary to make this plan sound, will our approach be evidence-based? And if I may, at the end of all of this process, when the mountains of paper have been safely stacked in a warehouse somewhere, someone is going to sit down and ask, were the conclusions reached here, conclusions which had regard to the representations made, and the evidence, not assertion, the evidence which was proffered? In relation to our representations, they clearly will, because the evidence is there. In relation to the council's position, for the reasons I've summarized, I respectfully suggest they would find it difficult. And then finally, from what Mr. Crawford said, don't misunderstand us, please, but the reason we've drawn attention to the compact city concept and its emergence is because there has been, we think, some inclination, as far as the council is concerned, to regard the compact city concept as something other than that which its originators intended it to be. Its originators did not intend that Cambridge should not grow. They intended that it should grow, as you can see from that little vignette in the top left-hand corner of the pen. the first plan in the benefits before the master plan proposal. City concept was not a concept which was intended to suggest that Cambridge would not grow, but to suggest that its growth would be in a compact and focused way, which is somewhat different, we think, to the interpretation of the council now, which is put on the concept of what the compact city and its growth. So those are our responses to what the council said dealing with Mr. Carpenter's points. Now, I'm next going to turn to Mr. Anderson to deal more specifically with the highways matters and define the name of Mr. Anderson as at the end. Is that to be
Mr. Anderson, did you think I'm coming? You have to.
Yes. Can I just deal very, very briefly just with two starting points right now? The first is a comment that has been coming grappled with the case being advanced by the promoters in support of the submission site. The focus of that comment seemed to be on the employment elements of these proposed allocation. The council fundamentally reject that submission. It can be reminded of the council's case presented in its written evidence, written statements. Oral representations to matter 4, to matter CC4, to matter SC7, and to matter 9, matter 9 being the issue of the number 3 units part of the 10. You must mention there can be no doubt whatsoever that the council understood, acknowledged, grappled with, and responded to the promoter's case. At risk of repeating a certain event a few moments ago, there is a fundamental disagreement between the council and the voters about the extent to which there is a need which needs to be articulated to allocate the impact of more financial related to problem forces and sites on the page. To draw the issues, and the council's position and that of the voters is set out in the numerous occasions and documents in which this issue has been addressed in the examination. And so far as the criticisms of the council's approach to the SA process is concerned, both in the original SA and in the SA then on the MC2021, the council considered this site CCSC1004 as one of the alternatives among many other initial sites and other sites. It considered the site on the same basis as the preferred option. That process was completed, as I've indicated, in full and express acknowledgement as to the nature of the proposed uses. Giving you a reference on page 252, and indeed on page 260, it's Dixon and Antony, in terms of employment land, that the proposal proposed 85,000 square metres of a science park is expressly acknowledged. Now, yes, the council did not say, well, this site scores a significant tick, a significant benefit, or agree, whatever, on the basis that it is delivering floor space next to the hospital that would be used for purposes of life science. So the reason why it is the council don't accept that that is a benefit of this particular site that justifies its preference. So why would the preferred strategy or the alternatives? That takes you directly back to the disagreement between the council and so if in this part it is being suggested there is some flaw in the way in which the site was assessed through the SO process, the reason the sign of passage is that it's not accepted was it just a part of the system. Yeah, and Mr. Roberts, I think he's just going to pick up on one in large fashion on the platform of the person agreed.
Yes, the reference has been made to Compact City and to Carrie Lewis, and I'd like to point to the council's matter 6 statement, paragraph, appendix 2 of paragraph 2.8. So the reference to Compact 6 goes all the way back to 1950, the Holton & Wright report. And a quote from that states that Cambridge should be kept to low level and retain the general advantages of a medium-sized town, and the special advantages of Cambridge and future development should be compact rather than sprawling. Reference is also made to Harold Lewis, and that's addressed in paragraph 8.2.16 of that matter 6 statement 2, which made it clear that Harry Lewis review was carried out by a professor for Cambridge Subregion in 1971 and looked at various options for the growth of Cambridge in the future. The preferred solution has to be expanded itself. And the important point to note is that it's rejected as both unfeasible and undesirable by the county council and district councils affected.
I think Mr. Dixon is going to say something about he will be having an important point.
The point about affordable housing and key workers, the original representation referred to this site potentially contributing to key worker housing, and it referred to potentially being achieving policy compliant levels. It's with this statement there's now additional references to specifically 10% extra key worker housing. So that's new information. We'll come back to that point later, I believe. And there was just another point about the site here, which has been made, but the point about page 262, the assessment of the site and the site route. I think it is important to acknowledge that the SA text there does acknowledge it's possible to link the site directly to Agriculture Road, and it would mean site cycle route links along the travel to the CBT site, so that it's clearly acknowledged the potential way to include things.
Thank you. Thank you, John. I'll finish this bit, and then I want to take a short break before we finally get to Mr. Addison. I'm not going to repeat what I've said already, but just dealing with the essay and its treatment of the site. We have not said, and you will notice Mr. Carpenter did not say, that the SA addendum did not look at employment provision. It refers to a proposal of an 85,000 square metre science park, but it treats it as footloose. And that's why the later document refers to quantum, as Mr. Carpenter pointed out. And the critical issue is that these representatives' proposals from the beginning have not advanced something which was footloose. We don't say to you, you need to consider whether housing might be provided to the north, east, or west of Cambridge and consider the options of those relative to this site. But we say to you, this is a proposal which is not footloose, needs to be assessed on the basis of being not footloose, is linked to CBC as being something which is a specific advantage of the location and the type of proposal, and is to be assessed on that basis. So all the references you can find about the prospect of quantum of development being provided to us by them are all well and good, but they don't deal with the case. And likewise, if I may say so, Mr. Dixon's comment, he is right. We said at the very beginning, one of the advantages of this proposal is that it will provide key worker housing in relation to a critically important, recognised in the plans, sector, that is the life sciences sector, linked to Adam Brooks. And CBC, as the JLL letter included in Appendix 1 of our matter 11.2 statement says this is all about people. This is about attracting and retaining people to support the acknowledged to be important life sciences sector. That's why the proposal had the key worker element in it at the beginning. And the SA does nothing to address that. Or, as I've said, the fact that this is not a footloose proposal. Helpful, if I may say so, then, to have Mr. Roberts' further enlargement of where the compact city has come from, but it doesn't change the force of the point which I put to you earlier, that compact growth is not inconsistent in any way at all with what we have proposed in the representations. So nothing else to say at this stage before turning to
the table. I think you have opposition.
Excuse me, you wish to continue there?
I'm happy to. You tell me if you want to stop that. I'm not sure what it is, what you want me to take
more. Okay, so very much at 11, I think.
In that case, I'll tell them to Mr. Anderson, and then we'll turn to the specific transport related or transportation related issues which he wants to raise. Mr. Anderson, thank you.
Thank you. We reference there seems to be some confusion in the documents as to exactly what the access strategy proposed is. And I thought it might be useful just to start with that so we're all clear what we're talking about. If you look at the master plan drawing, we prepared an access strategy for this site, taking cognizance of our experience in this area going back to 2003 with the earlier Southern Fringe applications and developments. And our knowledge that the constraint points on the network in this area are generally to the north and northeast of the site. So any difficulties experienced leaving the M11 junction are generally due to the congestion further up the network in towards the city centre on Trumpington High Street, or constraints where the new Ambrooks Road crosses the shelter of the Cambridge Road that signals there. So the strategy was prepared to direct site traffic away from those congestion points and where possible to actually alleviate some of the congestion at those points. So we're proposing three access points, one onto Ambrooks Road, adjacent to the Glebe Farm, or Glebe Avenue at least called now Access, conjoining those signals and taking the benefit of the existing pedestrian cycle signalised crossing at that location, which I'll refer to later in terms of whether that's severance or not. At that point, the exit from the site would be left turned out only to ensure the traffic was kept away from the signals at Ambrooks Road and Shelford Road, where we know there may be constraints. A junction to the southwest, the southeast of the site on Cambridge Road, which is called at that point, which would be all movements. And an access only point off the M11 junction. Similar to the one constructed in the last few years at Junction 7 of the A1M to serve the research campus that they have there. An added advantage of this is the route through the site from Ambrooks Road and the M11 connecting to Shelford Road would allow existing traffic that currently passes through the Shelford Road, Cambridge Road, Ambrooks Road Junction to follow the site access roads and take some of the existing pressure off that congestion point. So if we then look at, and I won't repeat the points that Mr. Carpenter has made about some of the accuracies in the sustainability proposed with the Deadman report. If I can take you to that, RDEMC 021, March 16. I hope I get the page numbers right because for some reason my page numbers are wrong. I think I need to remember them. We go from page 262 on the transport section there, and there are a number of references to the severance of Addenbrooks Road and the Hawkston Road to pedestrian and cycle movements, indicating that they could be overcome. I think just need to clarify, as I said earlier, that there is already pedestrian cycle services across Addenbrooks Road at the point where we're approaching the exit from the site.
part of the signals that have gone in already and they will be maintained. And further, there are additional services at the junction of Ambrose Road and Hawkston Road, movement across that north-south corridor.